crashing is definitely part of the sport. It's probably the best part of it, I reckon.
So what we're trying to do is match the regulations with the level of risk.
It's going to be pretty hard to justify soon risking somebody's life for something that a drone can do.
In rural Victoria, there are 50 pilots flying and crashing at speeds of up to 160 kilometres an hour, with zero risk to their health.
I'm looking forward to the sport growing massively, yeah.
Drone racing is one of Australia's fastest growing hobbies, but drones are not just toys.
The type of work that drones are being used for at the moment is typically the 3Ds, the dull, dirty, dangerous.
And dangerous points directly to the origin of the drone. The first recorded drone flight was in 1849, when Austria sent pilotless balloons filled with bombs to drop on Venice. It was largely unsuccessful. In the First and Second World War, both sides tinkered with drones, or air torpedoes as they were called then, but again, they failed. It wasn't until 1973 when the US military confirmed that it had indeed been flying pilotless reconnaissance missions over Vietnam. Fast forward 30 years and Amazon is spruiking the benefits of drones dropping parcels instead of bombs.
This amazing innovation then lowers itself slowly to the ground, drops off the package and flies straight back up to altitude.
But the big thing that's preventing drone delivery at the moment really is societal acceptance. We're just changing from this concept of drones as this scary thing off in Afghanistan dropping bombs on people to something which can help us in our society. The drones that we use are very different. They're between $5,000 and $120,000. You think of them more like flying robots than a flying toy.
Andrew Chapman is a professional drone pilot. His work allows him to map, survey and document uncharted territory like never before.
Australian UAV recently had a mission to Antarctica where James Rennie, my business partner, was on board the Aurora Australis. Previously on the missions down south through the sea ice, they would have a manned helicopter on board. And so that's something that you could use if you really got stuck. Manned helicopters are incredibly expensive to operate and also very dangerous conditions down there in the extreme weather. Whereas with the drone, it's easy. You know, you're not risking anybody's life to have a look out ahead.
So just about to launch, but spotted a couple of birds in our airspace, which is our major risk. Amusingly, the main threat to our drones is our wildlife. The wedge-tailed eagles just hate anything in their airspace, so they'll come and seek us out and try and knock us out. Don't want to say too specifically how many we lose, but yes, it's a constant problem, the eagles. They're a beautiful creature, but they hate drones.
But the Australian people, they love drones. In 2015, they were the highest selling Christmas present.
The real accelerating factor has been the electronics that are in your mobile phone. That being manufactured on such a wide scale has then dropped the cost, and that's all going into drones. With the exponential growth of drones and the number of them in the skies at the moment, it's a bit of a statistical certainty that sooner or later we are going to see collisions between manned aircraft and drones.
Police are investigating reports that a British Airways plane was hit by a drone as it was coming in to land at Heathrow Airport this afternoon.
Yeah, you've only got to look at YouTube and see some of the crazy stuff that's happening with drones and the incidents and accidents in the sort of smaller consumer drone space.
Whoa! Holy fuck!
And then there's the nuisance factor, which is already making the news a little bit.
About it. With the increase of drones in the sky, it's the Civil Aviation Safety Authority that has the job of policing them.
5 years ago, there was probably in the hundreds of recreational drones. There's now tens of thousands. So the growth has been quite extraordinary. It's now become its own sector in Australian aviation, and it's a challenge for regulators to keep up with that. Only a small number of infringement notices have been issued, but I think we issued about 15 in 2015.
In 2013, this guy was fined $800 for crashing into the Sydney Harbour Bridge.
I don't think there really is enough education for the public. I think that's a work in progress that the government and CASA are trying to work on, but the education is the key to keep the public safe. And there is a fairly negative connotation on the word drones. We prefer to call them quads or multi-rotors. My name's Rob Avery, I'm aka Birdman from the Next FPV racing team. So first person view is a camera on the front of the drone that's giving you the image from the drone back to your goggles. So what we see in the goggles is exactly what the drone sees.
So as soon as you put the goggles on, you get this immersive feeling that you're on the aircraft and that you're a pilot. So you could be an F1 fighter pilot, you could be, you know, doing loops, spins, you can do 160 kilometres an hour without any risk. So it totally takes you to another place and completely addictive.
As soon as someone sort of puts those goggles on and experiences it for the first time, they're pretty much hooked straight away. But girls don't love it. I think there's maybe two girls in Australia that drone race, and we want more. We need more women in the women in the drone racing fraternity, so we welcome them.
We're good?
Yeah, we're good to go.
We're in Ballarat at the D1 Drone Nationals. We've been doing okay. We've got Ben, who's going through to the finals tomorrow. We've got Quang, who did well today, but hasn't completely made it through, so he's going to be basically fixing and repairing the quads after you've crashed them and making sure that they're flying right.
Crashing is a big part of the sport. If you're not crashing, you're not really trying hard enough.
This is the first of its kind in Australia. It's a national event. We've got some big prize money up, over $15,000 in cash and prizes. We've got pilots from all around Australia, representing nearly every state. The course we have here at the Ballarat Exhibition Centre is a course about 180 metres in length. There are four air gates which we light up with LEDs to make it much more visible through the pilot's FPV camera.
Pilots, quads to the grid, please. Everyone, finals events will be five laps.
Today, Team X went really well. We had our rookie, Ben Baited, come in first place. Pretty much dominated the competition. Yeah, he's done very, very well.
Look, I likened drone racing to the internet 20 years ago, where the internet was slow, we would dial up. That's where we are now with drone racing. In another 10 years' time, it's going to be three times as fast, and you know the pilots are going to be so much more skilled.
One of the major things currently holding drones back is their ability to sense a potential collision.
It's really the drone being able to sense what is around it and take the action to avoid the obstacle, be that a person or a building or a car or an aircraft for that matter. It's not hard to envisage freight aircraft, for example, being operated without a pilot.
Trucks and cars, they can already drive themselves. I mean, there is the technology's there to do that. It's not acceptable by the public for someone not to be behind the wheel yet. And it's the same with drones.
You can't really argue with technology providing better solutions though. If it can do the same or a better job for cheaper, or if it can do just a better job, then over time it has to take over. You can't really hang on to the old ways of doing things.